our schedule just a little bit. So next week, we are going to have Dr. To for sign management to help us, give us the lecture. This is going to be maintained, going to be the same as the previous schedule. The change will be during these 2 weeks, October 8th and October 15th. The previous schedule, the innovation district brief will be 15. We switch, basically we switch between the 2 weeks, that's all. So we're going to have like listen to the brief on innovation district by Dr. Michael first. He's our dean. And then on October 15th, we will have a reflection session that all of you individually need to present your reflection. You have to collect ideas from your reports. Your report on journal, the weekly journal, we post on our Facebook group each week. Okay, so if you feel that you will, I would need you to check back to the whole diaries, the journals that you have posted on the Facebook, and check if you have done all week assignment or not. And if you're not, then please keep posting until you post all of them. And then you reflect on your presentation. You can use any tool, any platform, any methods. I would expect like 10 to 15 minutes for each presentation. You reflect. You reflect from what you have learned from your lectures and activities that you have done in this class. Okay, in your own way. Okay, so then after this week, we will continue with the starting of our KT workshop. Right? And then after that, we will go on with our project session, and then to present your project sessions later. Okay, so the project session will be the continual phrase from the kinetic workshop. Okay, I will handle it to Ajahn Yui. Okay, I've heard that you're going to have like some little trick after this class. I'm not sure if we still going to make it or not, but anyway.
Make it move, make it stay sustainable for a long time. your background is interior design.
Yes.
What about your photo background? So what do you think about?
Yeah.
About that?
Yes. So what do you think about the innovation industry in your point of view?
I have actually been involved that as part just a designer. I have just like a member of community or something like that. And I think the innovation industry is something which is not just built with designers to be like a place to work and hang out, but it's also the place which is considering the needs of the community's members and the residents. And from my opinion, the innovation district is not the innovation district before it takes everyone in. Like, it has to be area which is including every resident of the area.
So participation of all the residents or stakeholders in the area.
Of course, also, but make more like the residents. Like the people who are living in the area is the most important persons of the innovation district also.
So did you have a look at the like different approach in different cities?
Yeah.
In 19 cities. Yeah. And what do you think about that approach in what you've learned so far? And okay, since your background is in lighting, so how do you think lighting can contribute to this idea of the efforts of innovations?
It creates, especially during night time, where disabled people has to be more actively with each other. The community has to be very strong, warm. So the lighting has to be in the design that can help the people to feel safe and to have the lifestyle to enjoy what after the work time here.
Yeah. So lighting. Okay, our overall theme is innovation history. The definition or the approach I'm taking, so I've read some references. That's one researcher group that they collect case studies in different cities, and they said the first one was in Barcelona. Spain. So there's some part of, this is my understanding of innovation history. There are other professors that might introduce you in from that point of view. From what I did some research on innovation history is the way that you're trying to inject new energies into an area where maybe it was underused or it's inactive, underused, or there are potentials to become a more prosperous area for neighborhoods. So it can be just small neighborhoods or part of a city. So other examples in other cities like this, in the one in Spain, in Barcelona, and later on there were examples in more familiar cities like Boston, Seattle, in other big cities. But the common characteristics of innovation history in what they describe there is where you have an area, you take home ground side view, is where it used to be like industrial area, maybe deserted, and they probably have old warehouses not used. So the characteristics of those areas is, it's unused, but there are potentials in terms of the locations. Similar to here, like this area, for example, right? So there are potentials of being in the center of the town or the city. So they think that, by injecting new creativity, new energy into the area, they can develop the area or redevelop the area. So in other cities, what they in the case of Barcelona, so you can find more information on that. So in the case of Barcelona, it used to be this kind of like ex-industrial area. And in different cities, they have different models of how to develop this kind of operations. Like Barcelona is like it's a policy from the city. So the investment is only made by the city. So they, it's like designated area. This is innovation district. So they have, what are the plans for the innovation district? Okay. So what is that mean? It means that it can bring in the like tech, like high tech technologies into the area. And that's, so in this document, so they talk about some characteristics of successful innovation districts. For example, have an anchor institution. For example, university. Right? So they compare to Silicon Valley. So everyone knows Silicon Valley somewhere, as the name suggested, in the Valley. But they have these high tech companies in there, right? So they compare so that you see the pictures clearer. Innovation district means the opposite of that. So instead of somewhere far away, you have this clever and high-tech industry there. Innovation district is to bring those people into the city in a smaller scale, but they have anchor institutions, like universities, the one who can disseminate this high-tech knowledge or be the anchor of this high-tech industry, software or doing something with the IT, right? In the hope that, you know, by doing that, have the anchor institution, in the hope that that would bring in like young, creative and energetic people into the area doing these startups. So that comes to be a successful innovation district. So that would encourage a startup. So it's not big corporates. So you can see that if you compare to Silicon Valley, so it's breaking down into a smaller units of startup dealing with graphic design, but it's more like a web-based or using internet, using IT technologies. And also, they said not only a place for anchor institution, help people, new and young comers to the area, but that innovation district should have like affordable accommodations and also a place to work. So you can see, in these big cities, they have more of a co-working space, right? And also more innovative way to reuse like residential space, make it more affordable for younger people. Right? So it's not yet like in this area, but if this is the successful characteristics in other cities, can you see that this area can be innovation district? Maybe you don't know the area good enough, but you know the area well. You know the area well. Do you think this area can be innovation district?
I think it has a lot of potential. Because of transportation wise, in the future there are many projects around this area which are going to be developed. So
yeah.
I think with those projects, the city center is going to shift in a way from Seyam to more towards this side.
Hopefully, yes. Yeah.
So I think it's quite a good location as well, because the river passes through this area, and I think the river is also an identity of our city as well. And to use the river to our benefit is also, I think, another aspect which companies which should take advantage of the river as well.
I agree with you in terms of the potentials. I agree that, you know, this area has good potentials. And if you're looking, okay, we have what we have. We have anchor institutions, although we don't have like a formal classes here. But yes, we have some kind of education here. We bring in academics, researchers from the universities to here. And we're also trying to connect with private sectors, industry here. Opportunities in terms of locations. So transportation is directly connected to the city center, right? And also, when you talk about the river, so that's, what do you see the river? Physically, it's for transportation. Functionally, it's for, you know, transportation. But symbolically, and you know, the
symbology, I think it's like the bloodline of the city as well. I think so. Having a water body or something, it also contributes to the aesthetic value of the city as well.
Yes. And in terms of places along the river, how long have you been there?
Just a month.
Oh, okay. What about you? Longer. What do you think about the river? Yeah. Where do you live?
I live in
Sukhumvit area. Why did you choose to live in Sukhumvit area?
Because there is green down there.
It's a very obvious. I shouldn't ask.
No, not actually. I decided to that place because of good location and near MRT station and BTS.
Yes.
Obviously there are so many Korean restaurants also. That's why I decided. Because I didn't think like I live on other places, but I don't know about areas.
Yes. Okay, for you can see that on the river there are now more high end developments. Like condominiums now that they're building along the river. They're not like the one next to us here. You know, they are very, very high, very expensive. So they're targeting another group of residents there. But you can see that even developers, they see the potential of what the rivers can offer. Yeah. I talk about the river because in terms of lighting, we've been trying to influence, at least at the, you know, we've been trying to influence the public sector to put more attention and do it wisely and, you know, appropriately in terms of lighting along the river. It's not much of a success, I have to say. But it will be another dimension, you know, to contribute to, you know, by becoming an innovation district. Because like what Jane was saying about lighting design can contribute to like everyday life, right? Create safety and security, you know, and people can travel around, can walk around, you know, safely. So that is one aspect of lighting. How lighting can contribute to, you know, our effort of trying to be innovation. So first one is more functional, you know, everyday lighting for public lighting. So public lighting can be, you know, for this infrastructure like street light, pathway, and when we talk about river, what we have?
So we use the furry crossing. So we have lots of piers. Like on this side, 1, 2, 3. With the central, yours you went to Hongshan Pier, right? Hongshan Pier. So that's a big pier. That's one of the main pieces. But PFC Pier is a smaller one, so it's just for crossing the river. And then this passage. Yeah. So we have at least two small piers for crossing the river. Just in this stretch is from Sartong Bridge to Hongshan Pier, you walk to the top. So you have public lighting for the normal facilities. What else are public facilities? So we have piers. What else public facilities that you need lighting?
Stage lighting.
Can, do you think your expertise in stage lighting can contribute to innovative? What is your idea about innovation history and how lighting can contribute?
Stakeholders, of course local residents. Yeah, there are
residents in Muslim community. There's a big Muslim community that is Chinese Thai business owners and people in jewelry business. Is your company, is your family doing jewelry business? So in that area, there's jewelry business, but they're more like wholesale business, and they're also like custom-made jewelry. And jewelry designers, small galleries, artist studios, already in the area. So these are, and my lighting design companies, small, but we also in that area, so we were recruited as a stakeholder. So when they did that cooperation to everyone, so we were invited to participate, to give our comments, and so they asked us what we would like to see to change in the areas. They involve school children in the area. Yeah, so they have workshops with young people, with old people in the area. So they collect, like they would like to know what people would like to have, and how the creative business in the area can contribute to make the whole district more creative district. So that kind of workshop. So after the workshops, they have organized, they call it like a mock-up, a one-to-one, a full-scale mock-up of the result from the workshops. So they have defined, they define three things that they said, you know, there's a potential and the stakeholders would like to see it happen. So first one is they did some mapping of the area and they found that they are unused buildings. So some are warehouses, some are shop houses but not used. So people just have money and they don't do anything. Don't rent it out. Some old buildings and very nice architecture, and some are on the river as well. So one is the unused buildings, can be potentials for the area. Secondly is, you know that if you look at the map, the area is have a long stretch on the river, but people have no access to the river. So there is no public access to the river. Like they cannot enjoy it. When we talk about the path of the river, there's no path of the river. So that is one aspect that the local residents they would like to have. The third one was green space. So because most of the residents there, they are in shop houses or in condominiums or apartments. So people want to have green areas. So these are three components that, you know, come out of the workshops. So what they need for the full scale mock-up, so they just did small area of these three things. So our company was invited to do lighting of the public space on the river. So they rented out the area of, do you know Oriental Hotel? So Oriental Hotel, there's a pier next to it. And next to it is, there's an old building called East Asiatic buildings. It's very nice, kind of Western style buildings. Very nice architecture. Yeah, but now it's closed down and owned by TCC. The VHR company, and because to renovate it costs a lot, and I don't know what problems they have, but the building is still closed, they don't use it. And now the area next to the river is still, they don't do anything, they just use for parking. Or it's quite a waste when you see it and people have no access to it. So during the co-creation workshops, they rented that space. And so we do lighting for the facade of that I'll show you in the future. So we did the lighting for the facade of East Asiatic buildings.
introduce some elements that people in the area can participate if they like. So there are some handmade things you want to be part of that vehicle design. And they also have a mock-up, full-scale mock-up of green space in front of the post office. Yeah, and one day there's the ex-King UTT student, the one that or the company is called Eyedropper Field, the one that they use projection mapping. So they go around with a cart, with some projectors and iPad, right? So they go around on the street, on the road, and people who pass by, the residents, can play on the iPad and they project it onto the shop houses. So that's another way to get people, like, to raise awareness of the potential they have. But of course, that kind of lighting, you cannot have them every day. Okay? So you still, that's why I like you to think of, there are two main schemes, right? So the first one is something people can use every day. Can, if we talk about innovation district in terms of increase the local business, maybe even evening and nighttime. So people should be able to walk around safely, and then they feel safe to explore the area. Like if you're in the area, you're not familiar with the area, right? But to draw younger people in, you probably won't stay home. You probably would like to explore the river area. You hear 10 days a month, you probably would like to walk around. How do you feel now? What's the everyday lighting on the path?
For this street,
yeah.
The path, even though it's in front of the building, they stay, but it's not really taken care because it was about trees and shrubs. Sometimes we don't have holes. For us to walk to the Gongsan area, they are the bridge area where it's very dark. I feel very unsafe. I wanted to move over, but I couldn't walk.
Okay, so you see the consequence of not appropriate lighting. Maybe it's okay for, like for me, I live in this area, I know that, okay, you know, maybe this stretch is a bit dark, but because I'm familiar with the area, so I just walk past it, you know. But for people who are new to the area, if you talk about innovation district, you not only cater for existing residents, right? You try to bring in new people, new energy, more creative people. So what then you have to think, what are creative people like you looking for? What else that can draw you in? So people can enjoy the life of space in the public area. Or like every day, you know, like your daily activities, and maybe once in a while they also have festivals and events on it. What lighting design, lighting technology, and even when you think of maybe more innovative ideas can enhance that quality. Yeah, so now you see that there are some parts that you have to understand about lighting. Some part things is about, you know, being more creative, think about participation from different stakeholders. So in this area, we haven't done anything yet. What I have done was in the Beijing area. Last year, we were helping the Bangkok Dockland on the other side of the Taksim Bridge, the Bangkok Dock. So they have that, dry dock, a sunken area for big boats that they fix. And so we help them with lighting the one of their landmark. It's like a pulley, which is on the river. So far, we haven't haven't influenced the everyday lighting yet. So far, what I've helped them you know, in the cities and different groups of researchers or academics working on the urban scenes. So maybe it's the art festival or some kind of events. But we're trying to advise them in the city to do something permanently, properly, and so to create a more comfortable and respectful as well, like for places, important landmarks on the river. On the river, you have temples, you have mosques. You might not notice because at night time, it's just going to disappear. So we have temples, chedis, that the tall structure. So we have important landmark places on the river, which at the moment is still dark. But at the same time, lighting design doesn't mean that you just provide light. Lighting design means that when you know when to light and when not to light and what to light as well. So that is lighting design. But because now with technologies, there are other dimensions, like lighting is not static. Now you have dynamic lighting. It can be dynamic scenes, it can be dynamic colors. So all of this, you just have to understand you know, what and when to use these technologies. Yeah, for the temple, is it appropriate to use color? Is it acceptable you know, for like Buddhist people? Is it acceptable even in terms of colors? Because colors also have symbolic meanings of colors, right? Certain colors maybe Thai Chinese people like to use. Some colors they like to use. They like to use forward red, for example. Certain colors are not acceptable to use. So although we talk about lighting design, which might seem relying heavily on technologies, but you see that you still have to understand a lot in terms of people, how they use them, and how it's appropriate how to apply the technologies in the where you can do something. Okay, do you have any other, did you think of your example yet? Example of like innovative, for innovation history, how lighting can, apart from what I give for myself, how lighting can contribute. Smart cities. How smart? at home, do you have smart town or smart city?
No, we don't have that. But yes, promise, and it will be like in 2020. It's not ready, but they're considering that it will be like not hard to center the city, and it's quite like it's not a wide area, but it's still workable, like
street lighting for cars, at least in Thailand, I think on average. So they provide, they try to provide 15 lights on average. So for pedestrians, maybe 10 around 10. So for to design a space for cars and for people, it's different in terms of, okay, definitely light intensity will be reduced. What else? Yeah, so the proportion, the scale. So when you walk, you design something for walking. It's, you're not going to have a porch like 10 meters in China, but in Thailand you do. Yes, in front of the Bangkok Metropolitan Office, so they have like a station, like a spotlight thing, spotlighting plaza, which you probably don't see that in other countries. So the whole design will change. So the light level will be brought down. The scale of the equipment, light distributions will be different. Yeah. And you probably can think of maybe what light
Happy Street furniture can contribute to that. For example, if you have a light bulb here, so the scale would be like that. So this is light, and maybe they can integrate sensors. They integrate. Can they integrate information? So now they have technologies where lights, they can also can transfer information. But what I know is that in these days, there's still limitation. There is one way communication. It's not two ways. Like you cannot communicate back, but they can collect your information. Right? So it can give you, say if you are in this room, they can give you the information about, say there's a seminars or exhibition on Cisco about this and that. So you can use the information, use light to transmit information. Also as in the public scale. Right? So you can think of how these technologies can enhance the interrelationship in the public space. So it's not only for vision. It's not only for creating atmosphere that is friendly and new. So that's about visual. So in the future, your graphic design can be transmitted into light. So people can see the graphic or information that you explained about maybe little photograph in say radius of 500 meters. What are the tourist information? What are the history of that part? Something like that. So in the future, it's not, so that can be, I think in some, maybe some European cities they've done, maybe not a big scale, but they do it with bus stops, like a smart bus stop. So you go there and this whole line gives you information about the bus, collect information about like how many people use that area, something like that. So technologies will be part of this lighting design in the future. And in the larger scale, when they talk about smart cities, smart lighting is part of it, but it's more in terms of using, they talk about using the light poles to collect information, not only to transmit information to people. Last week I was in China, there's a guy from a Chinese company. So he was telling me that, oh, you know, he was going to Hawaii and to other, I don't remember what cities. But he's talking about like 10,000 street lights that the cities want to make it like a smart lighting. So I asked him, so what exactly you mean by smart lighting? So he said there are different levels of smart lighting. So the first like entry level, it just detecting when you walk, when you get close. So maybe it's just a different like adaptive one. So they have a sensor here and a wireless. So when it detects that you move closer to this area, the lighting will go up to 100%. When you already pass this area, it just goes down to say 50% or whatever level that you set. Why is doing that? What's the benefit to this? This is called like adaptive. Or sometimes it's called smart lighting, but it's not. It's a like entry level of smart lighting. Yeah, so when nobody walks past the area, the light level was set at the same 50%. Just half the power.
Okay.
So
you can save energy. But when you walk past, they know that you need, say, 10 lux. So it's gone up to 10 lux, 100%. So you can save energy. People can still feel, you know, comfortable and safe to walk around the aircraft. So this kind of technology, they've used them for a long time already in museums. But now we've started to apply to a public aircraft. But I don't think they use it for street lighting yet. It's more path lighting. In more a confined area, like in the park, they use this. And if you go to museums, I think you see them. At least I've seen them in China, museum in China. So if you, there's a display of a very old paper scrolls. So if nobody's there, then the lighting is very dim. When you see people approaching and the lights go up, and it's still up until the people walk past and it goes dim down again. So those kind of occupancy sensor, that's like entry level. That's the entry level of smart lighting. But so that Chinese guy, he tell me that, oh, the next level, you can collect information. And they have this wireless thing to transmit the information. Now, next is what the city is going to do with that information. At the moment, what they can do, they know which lighting is out, the lamp is out, they can go out and fix it. So it's like reporting back to the control center. In big cities in China, was in Shanghai, they control the lighting from the city. It's not each building switch on their own lights. I mean lighting for the building, for the facade, for the outside. Who have been to Shanghai? The bun on the bun. The side that they have four buildings from the European time. So that side, about 7 o'clock, between 7 to 11. So they switch on the lights of all the facade. Okay. So there's a lighting master plan, which we should have. There's a lighting master plan. So they decide what kind of, it gives you the guideline of what lighting technique should be used, what light density should be used, its color is allowed to use which color. So every 7 o'clock, someone at the city, or maybe they have a time clock, the light is on, not the buildings. You start the lights coming on. And it's complete the scene of the park. So the tourists take photos and enjoy it until like 11. It's off. Something like that. So that's part of how lighting control, you know, can be, can play a part in that, how to manage the city. But yes, of course, for smart lighting is doing more than that. It's probably respond to, for example, it's not a time clock, right? Because each season can be gets dark at different times. So they can have sensors of the ambient light. They can maybe adjust the brightness that they keep to each room. One else?
So interactive means that it responds to you somehow. Right? So what kind of interaction you would like to see in your public?
For example,
entertainment. Such as
playing games, friends or new friends or stranger, and you coming together.
So instead of just being function, right? So it's that's a possibility that smart lighting or interactive lighting can do this to enhance interpersonal relationship or maybe among friends or even strangers. So you can keep that one, you can introduce
or like encourage people to move more, more exercise. Or walk more.
Yeah, walk more, yeah.
Activity based,
such as right.
Activity based, like lighting, you mean actually like in like what you said, involve in activities different than active thinking. With projections on the floor or on the wall.
That's a good idea. So, graphic designers or interior designers, what do you think? What's your idea about, do you think interactive lighting can enhance like the public, the use of public space?
Emotion for people?
Emotion. To adjust lighting according to your mood?
No. That's the emotion.
It's emotions. Inside or outside of the room? Can be both. Yes, can be both. For example, can you give example? Yeah, but that's a possibility. See if I have.